I hope so. And yes, they can hear me say I hope so on there.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
It is so good to see all of you here today. My name is Griff Carosello, and we're so glad that you are worshiping with us here today. We are actually live streaming our 11 o'clock service here today. We had a few problems in our earlier service, so for those of you who are watching online, we are glad that you are watching with us, and let us know where you are watching from, and we'd love to connect with you a little bit more here in the future. One announcement that I do want to share with all of you is that this week we will be finishing up our sermon series called Broken. Next week we're going to be starting a new sermon series called Why Can't We Be Friends? Now within our division, our world that is full of division, we're going to talk for about 3 or 4 weeks about how we can love well in this world. And so I hope that you will join us and maybe even invite a couple of your friends to join us along with that. And for those of you who are watching online, we'll be streaming those services as well. And so as we start our worship today, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we are so thankful for the many blessings that you have given us. And Lord, we ask that above all else, you will send your Holy Spirit to us this day. And we ask that you will anoint our worship so that we can hear a word from you. We ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Church. And so I invite you today to affirm your faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today's responsive reading is from Psalm 105, verses 1 through 11. If you'll please join with us in the bold print. O give thanks to the Lord, call on God's name, make known God's deeds among the people.
Sing to the Lord, sing praises, tell of all God's wonderful works.
God, glory in God's holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Seek the Lord in his strength. Seek the Lord's presence continually.
Remember the wonderful works God has done, the miracles and judgment he has uttered.
The offspring of Abraham, God's servant, children of Jacob, God's chosen ones.
The Lord is our God, whose judgment are in all the earth.
The Lord is mindful of his
the covenant made with Abraham, his promise sworn to Isaac, and confirmed to Jacob as a statute, to Israel as an everlasting covenant, saying,
to you I will give the land of Canaan, and your portion for an inheritance.
This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Kids, I have a picture for you. I want to see if you can tell me who this is, okay? I got some kids over there in the corner. Can y'all tell who this is? He's on a penny. Who is it? Y'all know who it is? Pharaoh, who is it? You're right, Abraham Lincoln. Who was Abraham Lincoln? Y'all know? 16th president. All right, well, as you know, he was president at a very difficult time in our country, but he didn't lead alone. He had some help, of course. And he gave a speech one time that said, without the assistance of God, I cannot succeed. Without it, I cannot fail. So you can see that he relied on God to give him some strength, to give him some guidance, and that's part of what had him become one of the greatest presidents that we've had in our country. The Bible says that with God strengthening us, we will be able to do things that we find difficult. Well, right now, kids in particular, and I know some parents are too, but we're all finding things difficult in our lives right now, especially with school. We're adjusting our new routines. Teachers are trying to figure out how to teach the kids. The kids are trying to figure out how to do schooling, some at home, some in person, some going back and forth. So it's a difficult time right now. But I want you to remember that you can rely on God and ask him for help to get you through some of these times. For example, if you have a test coming up, you can ask him to help you remember some of the important facts that you need to know. You got a project, ask him for wisdom and guidance and to help you how to get that project started and completed. So just be like President Lincoln. Ask for God for help and assistance. You can always rely on him. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful that we can rely on you and know that you will guide our paths. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
word that I want to offer up to all of you, whether you're parents or guardians, whether you're here in person or watching online. I did mention this in the first service, and I meant to, but one thing that we are going to be doing on September 27th is we're going to be having a parent forum. Now, that sounds really official. It sounds very kind of uptight a little bit. That's the only name I could come up with something like this. So forgive me on that. But what it's going to be is, as Miss Amy mentioned to us, is that this is a crazy world. And what we want to do more than anything else is check in with our parents to see how they are doing, to check in with the guardians of any kids, and check in to see how they are doing, what we can be doing for you and for your family to support you, both as a church, but also just as friends. So September 27th, we'll be meeting here in the sanctuary at 4 o'clock. If you're a parent or a guardian or know of somebody, they don't have to be a member of the church to come here. Everybody is welcome to come and have this conversation with us. So just make a note of that, because we know that there's a lot of brokenness here in our world and a lot of broken schedules and broken rhythms and all of that. So we want to be there for our parents and for the parents of our community. So with all that said, let's dive into the sermon. We have been in this sermon series for 4 weeks. This will be the fourth week today, and it has been called Broken. Now, we call it broken because we see a broken world all around us. We live in a broken world, and what we have been doing is we've been walking through Paul's letters to the Romans. Now, the Romans were early Christians, early first century Christians, who were navigating their world around them, and they too lived in a broken world. And we've been taking a look a little bit at Romans. We haven't dove into it completely, but there's a lot in Romans. And what we've talked about the last couple of weeks is, well, number one, is to tell a complete story of what God is doing. We have to include both God's love and the sin of the world. To tell a complete story, we've got to talk about both God's love and the sin that exists in the world. And then we followed up that week to talk about what God is doing about that broken world and to talk about that there is no divide that is too wide for God's love, that God is at work repairing the world, and that no divide is too wide for God. And last week, we talked about how God has enlisted us into this mission as well. We don't just sit back and watch God and watch God do what he does and not participate in it. Instead, God calls us to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to believe that he has been raised from the dead, and lastly, to bring good news to someone. And so last week I challenged you to bring some good news to someone in your week. And so actually today what I hope to do is to bring you some good news. That even when the world is still broken, even after the service, even after the sermon series, when the world still seems broken and shattered, I want to offer you some good news about what God is doing about it. And so I want to invite you to pray with me today. Gracious God, you are at work all around us, and today we ask that you will be at work here in this place. Whether we are here in the sanctuary or watching at home, we ask that you will speak a word to us. We didn't come to hear me talk. We didn't come to hear my thoughts about Scripture. We came to hear what you would say to us this day. And Lord, we ask that you will speak to us so that we can hear you. We ask this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It's hard to find dependable people. It's hard to find people who are reliable. In fact, one of my friends and I, a dear friend of mine, we joke around about our friends from time to time because we send a text message to our group and we talk about how we are going to go do this on Saturday. And then, well, a lot of people commit to it. But we joke around about it because oftentimes they commit and then they back out at the last minute or they find something better to do than to hang out with their friends. So sometimes we see that sometimes people are unreliable, they're undependable. And a little bit of a confession today. I'm one of those undependable people or unreliable people, or I was at least this weekend. The same friend and I, we started a routine of running on Saturday mornings and I need somebody to hold me accountable. But this past Friday, my wife and I, well, we took a little trip to this place called Red Bowl in Greenville and got some chicken fried rice. And I had a little too much chicken fried rice on Friday. And so I texted my friend and said, I don't think I'm going to make it tomorrow morning because this fried rice is making me mellow and very calm. And I don't think I want to run the next morning. So we're all undependable from time to time. And we all want to see some of that dependability in our world. And even though I've seen a lot of unreliable people, I've heard a lot of really amazing stories about dependable people. And one of those stories is actually about a story of a member here at Sharon United Methodist Church. I met him about a year or so ago, and he has since passed on to the Church Victorious. But there was just a story about him of how dedicated he was. And Richard and Terry, if you're watching, please correct me if I'm wrong, but the story is about J.B. Waddell. Now, some of you know who J.B. Waddell is, and you know a little bit about him. Well, from what I understood, he worked at the same company for about 40 years, or over 40 years. And that kind of loyalty, that kind of reliability, isn't seen very often today. Mainly because sometimes the employees aren't that loyal to the companies, but also sometimes the company isn't always that loyal to the employees. But all that said, JB worked at the same company for 40 years. That's dedication, that's dependability, but there's one particular story that shows how reliable he is. Now, for those of you who don't know, we Southerners are allergic to snow. We don't like it, or we kind of like it, but when it happens, or there's even a threat of snow, we panic. We shut everything down, we don't know what to do with the roads. Most of us don't have four-wheel drive or anything like that, so we just try to stay at home. We take a snow day and let all the other crazy people get out on the road, and we try to avoid that as best as we possibly can. Now, some of you aren't Southerners, and you laugh at us when it comes to dealing with snow. I get it, but we know how to deal with heat. So we understand humidity and heat. But all that to say, a few years ago, there was a, I put air quotes, bad snowstorm here in South Carolina. It may not have been as bad compared to other places, but it was a pretty bad snowstorm here. And as is characteristic here in South Carolina, everybody's freaking out. Companies are shutting down. Schools are shutting down. They're taking a snow day. But JB wasn't about to take a snow day. And even though the world was chaotic, even though the world was really dark, early in the morning, he stepped out into the world, all the snow all around him, and he got a couple of cinder blocks and walked over to his truck and put those cinder blocks in the back of his car because he wasn't going to take a snow day. He was going to go to work. He put these cinder blocks in his car and he makes his way down to work. And when he shows up to work, there's only a couple of people who were there. JB was the only person who showed up and who didn't take a snow day. And the only couple of other people that were there were the security guards who had spent the night there the night before. JB refused to take a snow day. And that's reliability. That's being dependable. That even when there are all these obstacles in your way, in his way, he went above and beyond it to make sure that he could make it to work. And a lot of us, well, we want to know somebody who's as dependable as JB. We want to have those reliable friends who will always show up at a moment's notice. We want to have a dependable job that we know will be there next week and even years down the line. We want to know that we have a church who won't give up on us, who won't reject us when things get a little messy, when they get a little tough from time to time. We all want that dependability. But the truth of it is all of those things at one time or another will fail. They won't always be dependable. They won't always be reliable. From time to time, those things will let us down. Those relationships, those friends, those family members, those jobs. And yes, even sometimes the church will let you down. So where do we turn to find that dependability? Well, all too often, we start with ourselves. Because we're the only person that we can control in our life. We're the only person that we can rely on. And so we adopt that attitude that we can pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. We can muscle our way through this situation. But then what happens when we can't? What happens when we can't muscle our way through? What happens when we can't navigate the snow and the ice without putting ourselves in danger? What happens when we are at wit's end and there is nowhere else to turn? That's where God steps in. That's where we find the dependability of God and the faithfulness of God. And so today I want to invite you to hear these words from Romans chapter 11, verses 1 through 2 and 29 through 32. These are words to the Roman Christians that Paul is sharing, reminding them of how God is reliable to all people. And so here is what Paul writes. I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people whom he foreknew. For God's gifts and his call are irrevocable. Just as you who were at one time disobedient to God have now received mercy as a result of their disobedience, so they too have now become disobedient in order that they may too now receive mercy as a result of God's mercy to you. For God has bound everyone over to disobedience so that he may have mercy on them all. So what Paul is highlighting for the Romans is how dependable and how faithful God is. And for us to bring that story of JB back to full force, I want to apply it to this passage here. I want you to remember this, that God doesn't take snow days. God doesn't take snow days. The question that Paul is dealing with is maybe a strange question to us. We sometimes forget how strange Scripture can be because we're bridging about 2,000 years worth of history. But for the early Christians, this was a very important question. And the question that they were asking was this: has God rejected Israel? Has God given up on the people of Israel? Now, this question, it doesn't really impact us the same way. And I think that's all too often because we forget that, well, Israel is still God's chosen people. Or the Jews are still God's chosen. As the story goes, God made a promise to the people of Israel through Abraham, through Moses, through David, to bring about salvation to the entire world. And what God promised to them was this, that they would be saved and that he would bring about salvation to the rest of the world through the people of Israel. And so the expectation for the Israelites was this, is that when the Messiah would come, the Israelites would be saved first. And then after that, the Gentiles would be saved, all the non-Jewish people would be saved following all of that. But that's not what happened. Sure, there were a few Jewish people who accepted Christ. There were a few Jewish people who began to follow Jesus Christ. That's the story of Acts of the Apostles, and that's even the story of Paul himself. He mentions that. I am an Israelite. God hasn't given up on Israel because I am an Israelite. But what they've been seeing is this, is that while Israel was there and existing, Israel had rejected God's Messiah. And now the Gentiles all around Israel began to convert to Christianity. They began to claim Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to believe that he has been raised from the dead. They began to see that a lot of Gentiles were coming to the faith. And so the Roman Christians were asking this question, has God rejected Israel? And it's an important question, because at the heart of this question is a question about God's character. It's a question about whether or not God is really faithful, or whether or not God is really trustworthy. At the heart of this question is whether or not God is dependable. Because here's the thing, is that if God could reject Israel, then what is stopping God from one day rejecting the Gentiles? And in the same way, is that if God could reject Israel, what prevents God from rejecting us someday? That's at the heart of this question. Has God rejected his people? Has God broken his promise to Israel? And in the face of all of that, Paul shouts out, no! Absolutely not. God is faithful. As Paul says, by no means has God rejected Israel. Why? Because God is faithful. God keeps the promises that he makes. His promises, his gifts, his calling, all of those are irrevocable. All of those things are trustworthy and true. All of those things you can count on. Why? Because God is dependable. And God one day will provide mercy for Israel in the same way that God has provided mercy for us Gentiles. Paul is reminding the people, the Roman Christians, and us today, that God is faithful. Now, perhaps one of the things that the Romans struggled with was superstition. Because they had a lot of gods that they believed in. They believed in a pantheon of gods. They believed in a lot of spirits that were at work in their world as they saw it every single day. And their thought process was this, is that the gods, well, their gods were a little petty. They were a little, well, moody from time to time. And they had to be appeased. They had to be prayed too often. You had to make sacrifices to them. You had to attend their temple, because if you didn't, bad things were going to happen to you. Or if you didn't, they would send some spirits to cause some trouble within your life and to draw you away from their blessings, to draw them away from all of that prosperity that they had once enjoyed. And so they were a little superstitious. They were a little, you know, thinking that gods were fickle. They needed a reminder that the God that they believed in, that Jesus Christ, was not like these other gods. That Jesus Christ was not like these other spirits at work, but instead that Jesus Christ is faithful. That God keeps the promises that he makes. And that above all, that even if they didn't do exactly what they were supposed to do, God wasn't going to give up on them, because God was dependable. Because God doesn't take snow days. Now for us today, we kind of look back a little bit on those Romans and think how silly they were to believe that way. But you know, I think sometimes we're superstitious too. We're superstitious that if we don't act exactly the right way, that if we don't say the right things, that if we fall out of the habit of praying to God, if we fall out of the habit of attending church, if we fall out of the habit of reading scripture, God will give up on us. We are superstitious too. We ask that question of, has God rejected Israel? Because, well, I don't have it all together myself, so God could give up on me as well. And whether we were taught that, or whether that's how we were raised, whether it's within this church or another church, sometimes we get that mentality that our relationship with God is a transaction, that we have to make deposits in order that God would give us blessings. But Paul reminds us today that God is faithful. That no matter what situations we find ourselves in, God is dependable. And that God does not go back on the promises that he makes. That God hasn't given up on you. So no matter where you are in your life, no matter whether things are going exactly the way you planned it, no matter whether all the plans that you made one day are out the window, no matter whether it feels like you have it all together or it seems like everything around you is broken, God is still faithful. No matter where your relationships are, no matter whether it seems like those relationships are draining you, no matter whether it seems like your friends continue to let you down, no matter whether it seems like your church continues to let you down, God is still faithful. Even when it feels like the brokenness continues to pile up, even when that brokenness that exists within us seems to try to separate us far away from God, God is still faithful. Even if you have gotten to that point where you are ready to give up on God, whether you are ready to give it all away and say, I have given you everything, God, I'm giving up on you, God has not given up on you yet. God is faithful, and God's words are final. Or to put it another way, even when the world is chaos, even when the world is dark, even in the world where there is murkiness and there is so much unknown, even in the world where there is so much brokenness and so much division, even in the world where there seems to always be a snowstorm right outside our doors, or even a snowstorm that exists within our own souls. Even when the snow seems to pile up time and again, where it seems like there is no way that we can get out of this, and there are people panicking everywhere, even in the midst of the craziest of storms, God steps out into the world, picks up a couple of cinder blocks, puts them in the back of his truck, climbs in, and he goes to work. Why? Because God doesn't take snow days. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, today we shower you with our thanks and our praises. Everyone in here has so many things to be thankful for, and we all know that the blessings in our life come from you, and we want you to know that we are so very gracious for these gifts that you give us. Thank you for never taking snow days. Thank you for always being there when life gets hard and we need someone that we can rely on. We pray that you show us your beauty every day as we try to walk in your light. We pray that you give health and hope to those people who are sick and are hurt. We pray that you give comfort and peace to those people who are grieving. And we pray that you give guidance and understanding to those people who might be lost. We pray for all of us here today, Lord. We pray that you lead us on a path that you have planned for us. We pray that you grant us mercy and forgive us of our sins. Let us understand that it is by our faith that we are saved. We ask for your Spirit to work through us. Allow us to let your light shine through us and illuminate the world with your goodness. With all these, let us now join together in the prayer your Son taught us using these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Before we close in prayer, I want to share a couple of announcements with you. The first two are more business related. If you are on the Staff Parish Relations Committee, we will have a meeting here in the sanctuary tonight at 6 o'clock. We're going to cover a few items of business. So Staff Parish Relations Committee in the sanctuary here at 6 o'clock. The other is that if you are on the nominations team, we will be meeting on Tuesday at 6:30, also here in the sanctuary. So just please make a note of that. We're going to be working on nominations for 2021. And the last thing is a little bit more exciting. It is an event that we are holding on September the 12th. We will be watching a movie here off towards the gym. We're still working on some of the logistics, but we want you and your family to come and join us. We're going to practice safe social distancing. Bring your own chair, sit far apart. We will have prepackaged snacks. We're doing this as safely as we possibly can. We think that this is a good way for us to be able to get together, but we do ask that we continue to social distance even in that environment as well. That'll be on September the 12th at 6:30. If you're in need of more information, please be sure to contact me or the church office. We'll be happy to share some more information from that as well. And I just want to remind you again, thank you so much for being here. We're going to close in prayer here shortly, but continue to wear your mask on the way out the doors back through here. And practice safe social distancing, and let us know if you happen to test positive or have been exposed to COVID-19. give us a call. We have some protocols that we have to follow in response to that. And so I want to invite, who's closing us in prayer? I was told Ben White was closing us in prayer today. So if you will stand, and Ben will lead us in our closing prayer.
Father, give us grace to live sweet to the full, being true to your word in every way. Jesus, help us to give ourselves away in service to others and for your gospel. Spirit, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Amen.
Not really. I mean, they gave us, you know, that's all. And actually, I'm going to tell you, seven or so first.
We're coming in.
Anyway,
I don't even know.